Welcome back to the Windows Azure Pack Jumpstart, focusing on our infrastructure as a service. I'm Simon Perryman, technical evangelist, and I'm joined this time by Andrew Zeller. Now, where we are today is we're really going to be focusing in this module on actually integrating the fabric. So as we've kind of gone through our journey today, we've really kind of done the initial deployment and really try to understand those setup requirements. Now, right now, we're really going to focus on deploying our core set of infrastructure components, the storage, the network, the clusters, and the compute resources. But with that, I'll turn it over to Andy to let him introduce himself.
My name's Andrew Zeller. I'm a technical program manager at Microsoft, or product manager, actually. My focus is on the service delivery tier of the Windows Server System Center and Azure Pack products, right? So I tend to approach all of the products from that top-down view, going all the way down into VMM, but I tend to live up above the stack.
Great. So what are we really going to cover as part of this section here?
Yeah, so today what I want to do, so we have an hour to get all the way through the whole fabric. So what I want to do is I want to talk about the point of view of the fabric from the top down. We tend to start and approach the fabric from the bottom up.
For the hardware and build
it. Right. Okay. That tends to be the way we do it. So I kind of want to invert it and say, let's approach it from the other end and talk about it that way. And then talk through the architectural principles and tools that are there throughout the stack to help you enable the things that are required from that top-down view and according to the services that you're trying to deliver. And then the next thing we'll talk about and we'll end on is the discrete places where the System Center stack connects into Windows Azure Pack, and take a focus on how to work with and manage the VM roles that get integrated into the Windows Azure Pack.
Great, and I think one important thing to note is we're not going to be spending this session talking about how to build these different components within Virtual Machine Manager. We're kind of having an assumption that you have kind of the basic Virtual Machine Manager understanding, so we're really going to be talking about how to go integrate that existing environment. If you do want additional Virtual Machine Manager training, check out the Microsoft Virtual Academy under the System Center filter, and we actually already have several courses that will take you end-to-end everything you need to know with Virtual Machine Manager. All right, let's talk about the service models.
Yeah, so one thing that's really important to think about when you start planning out a WAP implementation is that each of the discrete service models that are delivered through the WAP platform have implications on your fabric backend. So I put together this slide because I kind of want to try to establish the line, right? Like I want us to start thinking about this line of responsibility. And in the developer space, a lot of times you'll talk to a developer and they'll talk about their minimum viable product. And so what I'm trying to illustrate here is sort of the responsibility of the minimum viable service. So what I'm pointing out is that the blue here, let's say, is the responsibility of the user of the tenant who's subscribed to your services. The green is the responsibility of the person providing the fabric, right? So if you're operating on-prem, you have to manage everything yourself if you're not providing services in a traditional model. Once you switch over to a services model, then what you're going to be doing is at the minimum for infrastructure as a service, the provider owns the compute, the storage, and the network, and the physical resources underneath. And we're assuming that the end user is able to create, provision, destroy, and manage inside of their tooling in the Azure Pack their own virtual machines and everything that operates in them. That's the minimum service. That's not to say that that's the extent. You can start adding in services to help patch OSs. You can add in services to help do additional work inside of a SQL install that they may have in their environment. But the point here is to try to emphasize that minimum level. And so each of the service models has a different line that you have to account for. So if you use the websites that Bradley showed in the first session, then that would be the platform as a service, and then the database as a service, which allows end users to provision just a single database, would have its own set of fabric and management responsibilities on the back end. Until you ultimately got to a software as a service model, which WAP really isn't a software as a service platform, it's intended to provide those core service models. That's not to say you couldn't build a SaaS application through WAP and then present that out to end users.
And you mentioned this line. So just to clarify, this line is essentially tenant views versus infrastructure administrative views and responsibility. Is that right?
That's right. I mean, if you think about what happens when you connect to Azure, there comes a point where you stop having access to the environment. And everything past that point is taken for granted.
Right, it's hidden for me as well.
Right,
I can't even change things if I wanted to.
Exactly, so with the Azure Pack and doing it on-prem and being able to customize it, you're able to sort of, if you need to, say you're inside your own organization and you do want to create some holes in your line, it's possible to do that. If you're operating as a service provider, you definitely don't want people to have access into the back-end infrastructure, well, then that it's going to be much more similar to Azure. So that's just sort of the way that I wanted to try to go through that to try to establish that.
Great, that makes a lot of sense. And just to clarify on that diagram, we saw the C, S, and N, compute, storage, network, kind of the traditional infrastructure components.
Cool. So before we go too much farther, I just want to take a second and do this as quick as I can, because this is something that comes up a lot when I talk to people, is what is it that we're actually talking about when we talk about all of the IaaS, the PaaS, and all those various objects. So each one of these is a specific delivery model, like I said, and each fabric behind it has a specific set of design and requirements that you're going to have to administer. But with the introduction of focusing on delivering something as a service, you're committing to yourself to actually operating your fabric as a service. And so it doesn't matter what the resource is that you're providing on the back end through the Azure Pack, the approach to your design and your delivery of everything that you've got up and running needs to be operated that way. So when you break it down, and what do those things all have in common when you're doing anything as a service? Well, the reality is now you have to start focusing on treating everyone as a customer. So service providers that could be in the audience right now, you're already doing this, right? This is the way that you've approached everything. If you're in an IT shop inside of an enterprise, you might not necessarily think of the people inside your company as customers, but if you start trying to deliver things as a service, which is what Azure Pack is built for, because that's what Azure is built for, then you're going to start wanting to incorporate these concepts, right? So you need to start thinking about the fact that customers want choice, self-service, and they want to start focusing on limited approvals. And these are all the things that you start enabling in the forms of the plans and through the Azure Pack itself. Then there's going to be a business element, right? So this accountability structure and associating all of these resources with money and associating everything you're delivering with the bottom line, so to speak, is very important. So there's an emphasis on making sure that you associate things with costing, not necessarily to charge people, but at the very minimum to show back, right? Businesses are expecting more invention a lot faster. They're really driving, and so the cloud model and the self-service is really being driven by the fact that people want to start bringing new lines of business and new applications and services and improve their existing ones much, much faster. And then ultimately, they're hoping that they get a cloud scale success, so that whatever they build originally, they're trying to design so that it can become enormous, right? And they want to be the next big thing. And then finally, the developers who are working against the infrastructure as a service, the beauty of the cloud model is that now developers are starting to, and already are, and they're really thinking about developing their applications in the context of abundance, right? They don't have to design things to be correspond to the minimum level possible. They're not constrained by that. So they're actually intentionally building their applications to consume as many resources as possible, and then they're engaging with their applications much more directly. And writing in a lot more of the instrumentation into the applications themselves. So I just wanted to take a second and do that. So as we go through, so as you take that set of requirements, what are the things that you're going to need to provide through your fabric and your WAP implementation? You're going to need to be focused on predictability. So as the end users are approaching and engaging and deploying your infrastructure, they're assuming that you are going to meet your SLAs, right? So when you plan your strategy out for what you're going to do in your fabric, you want to make sure that you are very, very clear about what you present up to the service administrator layer so that they can construct their plans and offers in such a way that people get exactly what they expect. Because it's much better to know what you're getting, because sometimes all you need is something that's not that performant. And you just want to make sure that you always get what you're doing, what you pay for. And so when you design out your fabric, that you keep that in mind. The choice of service models is really important. And then like I was talking about with the accountability, you want to actually be able to offer different consumption models. So you start doing your planning based on fixed pricing, on bursting, and on as a pay-as-you-go model. And like I said, and then all of that wraps up into the financial reporting and the transparency back to the customer.
Now, do you have any best practices when people are thinking about, you know, how they want to offer these prices? So, for example, if we have cheaper hardware we want to direct certain customers to, is there a way that administrators may be able to expose that to kind of, you know, drive those decisions?
Yeah, I mean, this is definitely something that you're going to want to associate in the upfront agreements and arrangements with people when they choose to subscribe to your plans, right? Yeah. These are all the things that you're going to say are my terms of service. So if you have a whole lot of hardware in your back end that's sitting empty because of a certain performance requirement, this might be a good indicator that you're A, charging too much for it. This is something service providers are well aware of. But if you switch over to this model as an enterprise, then you're going to want to start working with your service offering team to say, hey, we need to start dropping these prices, get people onto this hardware so we can make maximum use of everything that we have that's being presented up into the service.
I think that's an important point. You know, when you're thinking about setting this up, you got to think about that these plans actually guide what hardware people consume. So again, really try to think, hey, if I need this hardware to be used or that, you can guide people to that based on how you structure these different plans and service offerings. So keep that in mind. We're not just managing the hardware. We're managing the services that then go and connect down to that hardware as well.
Yeah, that was perfectly well said. So I'm going to jump over to the next slide here. And on this slide, I've got the System Center for WAP slide. And what I've done is I kind of tweaked this slide a little bit just to give everybody a sense of context of where. Now, every piece of the System Center suite can be definitely used in your fabric administration. There are just certain points throughout it where there's kind of a little bit extra emphasis for how it relates to WAP. So we have the Windows Azure Pack sitting on top, connecting everything down through SPF. But with Virtual Machine Manager, you're doing a lot of your fabric management activities exactly as you would if you weren't using WAP. But what you're going to add is extra emphasis on the library and on the cloud, because those are two of them, and on the VMM clouds, because those are two of the main things that integrate into WAP. For Operations Manager, you want to start thinking about Operations Manager not only for the host management, application management, all the normal things, but it's going to be the place where you're going to be doing a lot of the usage tracking, ultimately for the cost transparency goal. Then with Service Manager, the majority of the focus through Grid Pro is on being able to customize and create new and additional requests that are hooked up to automations either with Orchestrator and or SMA. And then with Data Protection Manager, and this is something that I saw come up in the Q&A earlier, so currently Data Protection Manager is not actually exposed through the WAP portal as a tenant-facing service, but it's definitely something that you can think of when you say, okay, well, what are my terms of service, and I want to add additional functionality and additional capability to a customer. So service providers do this, and it's typically called an add-on. When you and your enterprise are doing this, you basically are giving people the option to say, hey, you know what, this is important. Can you take care of this on the back end for me? And this is something that you can do through that service manager integration or through add-ons and automation. So I'm going to switch over now, and we're going to talk about, let's just take a quick look at how VMM is set up so that we can focus on what the actual key points are. So like I said earlier, the key points of integration are that piece of the VMM architecture that goes out to SPF, and what that's going to end up being is effectively your clouds, and that is what is going to show up inside of WAP when you start trying to configure things. And then on the other side, you've got the library, and there are certain library artifacts and records that show up and become available, again, through SPF and can be integrated into the WAP, into the WAP system. So those things are VM templates and the operating system images that get associated with VM roles.
So let me just ask a clarifying point comment here. So WAP in itself does not have a requirement for VMM unless you want to actually go and provision this type of virtual infrastructure. Is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. Well, great. Well, let's move on to some of our architectural principles and tools here.
Yeah. So one thing that as I go and I talk to people, a question I get asked a lot is actually, why am I doing this? Why are we transforming things? Why are we trying to do this? And that's, again, why I was trying to start with, you know, satisfying what customers are after. And so when you're trying to meet the objectives that your customers have, then you are going to want to take certain principles based on the things that the capabilities that you're going to let them have, and as they provision things against your fabric, you want to design your fabric in such a way that you're able to support all of those capabilities that your tenants have. So one of the core things is adopting the sense of decay over failure. A lot of IT operations is predicated on a concept of things fail and mm-hmm. I fix them, mm-hmm. right? And so as soon as something starts to have a blinking red light, we open a ticket, we go fix it. With a decay model, we're saying, yeah, we're not surprised things fail. In fact, we designed everything to account for this. And so we can actually tolerate a certain amount of failure on our physical infrastructure that we really are okay with, because the things that we've done through pooling and other pieces and focusing on resiliency allow us to have that. So if I have 100 hosts, that's my pool of hosts, and I've decided arbitrarily in my example that 10% can fail, they're just going to sit there not working. And all it is it's a loss of a certain percentage of a whole. And as long as that's within my acceptable threshold, I don't do anything. And then when I do go and implement my fix, then I do it in bulk. And then I can automate and make that process a lot smoother. Again, minimizing human involvement in that way and focusing it and making it less iterative and random lets you have much more formal and practice procedures. And then another principle in decay is to start thinking of the fact that all I'm really after in my fabric is a pristine state. Once I know what a pristine state is, I'm able to go ahead and just start snapping back to that state, right? Just like if I took a VM in Hyper-V and not even anything here, and I just make a checkpoint and I say, that's good, and that's what I'm going to use in my demo later. And then if I have a problem, I just roll back to the checkpoint. I actually don't have those in my demo. But anyway, the point is that you start treating your entire fabric in that way.
Yeah, I think really kind of the big conceptual change is you're no longer managing these individual servers. You're managing your fabric as a single, highly available, distributed system. And parts of that distributed system can come up and come down, and that's okay, so long as that end-to-end system stays healthy. Now, I think the next concept is scale units, right? Let's walk through this.
Yeah, so John talked a bit about this in the form of stamp, because scale units, stamp, pooling, these things are all sort of terms that live together and concepts that live together. But what we really want to do is think about these scale units as modular units of measurement of disparate factors, right? So when we want to actually think about, when we define scale units, do we want to start crossing traditional boundaries, right? So, you know, in compute, we typically think of, you know, RAM and CPU. We have, you know, I/O in our storage. We have bandwidth in our network. We can take aggregates of separate sets of those kinds of measurements, or we can start crossing them over to create broader sets of units. And then when we make our plan for scaling out, we make our planning with those known predictable units in a highly repeatable pattern that we can then automate and stamp out over and over and over again. Again, minimizing human involvement and reducing the costs and improving the predictability, because we know that everything's going to be the same every time because we've planned it this way. So we don't iterate and try to implement micro improvements every time we do our fabric. We really want to make the effort that the actual big improvement is going to be through that repetition. So it becomes a main tool in your approach to managing growth throughout your infrastructure. So like I was saying, so pooling and scale units. So if we click into what we're going to start, what are the things inside of VMM and in our fabric that we are going to start using to define and think about these? What we want to do is we want you to take advantage of your existing infrastructure, which is going to have different performance requirements. You're going to be able to present that up in your fabric, but we also want you to be able to start adapting to the new JBOD storage model with storage spaces.
Yeah, so let's walk through this diagram a little bit. Now, as we're trying to think about moving to this JBOD, or just a bunch of disks, kind of the key concept here is really the commoditization of hardware. One thing that we're trying to do with Windows Server is essentially be able to provide that as the storage fabric controller. If you think of what a traditional SAN is, you know, something you might buy from one of these large OEMs, you have spinning disks, you have the controller that does the logic, the processing, like deduplication, storage tiering, and then you have connectors that allow you to actually access that data. What we've tried to do here is essentially for that management layer, be able to use Windows Server file services. So if we go back to the diagram here, you could see that we have our collection of physical disks. With this, we create what we call a pool of storage, storage pools. On top of that, we can then go and carve up this large blob of storage into what we call different storage spaces and assign a volume to them. So let's say, for example, I have about 30 disks here. Maybe they're a terabyte each. This means that we can create a pool that's about 20 to 30 terabytes large, accounting for things such as hot spares, failover, redundant disks. Once we have that pool of, let's say, 25 terabytes of storage, we have the flexibility to carve that up as we want. Now, a key concept here is that we're going to be managing this centrally, using something such as Virtual Machine Manager as our controller. Now, with Virtual Machine Manager, we essentially go through a process of connecting our VMM management console to the individual storage providers. So if I wanted to go connect to iSCSI storage, I would essentially connect and authenticate Virtual Machine Manager to my iSCSI target. From that point onwards, when I needed new storage for my virtual machines, I simply say, VMM, give me new storage. VMM then goes and speaks to the iSCSI target, and then the iSCSI target goes and provisions that storage and sends the information back down the chain up to me as the end user saying your storage is now available. So again, this is our goal of reducing costs by commoditizing storage here. And we're going to talk a little bit more about SMB storage as well in a little bit, how we kind of change things for Hyper-V. Next thing we want to think about is around our networking, around our compute and how we go and centrally manage that. Now, when we're thinking of compute, we're thinking about the physical servers, all of that processing power, which really breaks down to the memory and the CPU. Now, we want to, again, pool all of that information, similar to the storage, and centrally manage it. This, again, gives us that flexibility, that dynamicness. So when we say, I need more memory for a VM, we simply go to the pool and go and take that memory from there. The third concept that we want to think about as well is around virtual networking. Now, when we do our networking, again, we want to use the same centralized model where we're aggregating the physical resources, adding a virtualization layer on top, and then managing it through our single centralized controller. Once again, Virtual Machine Manager. So taking a look at this diagram here, you see that our underlying fabric at the very bottom contains physical resources, things like routers, switches, load balancers. But anytime we have to go touch those physical components, we have to think of the complexity of things like subnets, IP address schema, failover between sites. And that often takes a lot of time. There's management overhead, there's complexity, and if you're doing this manually, there's a chance you'll make a mistake. Humans make mistakes. So our same concept of adding this virtualized layer now applies here. We're essentially going to create what we call a logical network. And through Virtual Machine Manager, you'll say basically, I need a new logical network. And within that logical network, you get to define the underlying hardware setup, the different subnets, the different sites, the different domains. Now, from this point onwards, when you want to go deploy a new virtual machine, you can now say, go deploy it to my network. Go deploy it to the Corp.net network. And under the covers, we will take care of that complexity. We will figure out which network resources it needs to access, which IP addresses it needs to use, etc. Now, we could continue to build on top of that as well and create what we call tenant networks. And I think, Andy, you want to talk about that a little bit, right?
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing that Of all of these layers of virtualization across compute and storage, layering on this virtualization layer on top of network is probably the most important innovation that really just drives home the fullness of the WAP solution as a infrastructure as a service model, is that tenants can provision their own networks. They don't actually have to actually open a ticket, ask for configuration changes. They can provision them themselves, create them themselves, and configure them themselves. And all of that experience and the ability for them to do that was really probably the last thing that had to happen in order to make infrastructure as a service incredibly efficient and optimal for end users.
Great. Now, as we kind of talk about high availability and, you know, keeping things always running, we kind of shift the model from thinking about traditional server availability to service availability. Now, going back to this model of decay over failure, right? Remember, things can gradually fail. That's okay. Our key goal for us as IT pros and our end user customers is to keep the service online. And remember, this service is often a distributed collection of VMs, multiple tiers with front end, middle tier, back end that scale out across each tier as well. So long as you have one or more of those VMs alive running in those different tiers, your service stays online, even as different pieces of the hardware fail, recover, come back online. And so one of the core technologies that we're going to require here when we think about deploying our fabric is failover clustering. Now, failover clustering is a high availability solution for when you need a single centralized pool of information. Now, this kind of differs from load balancing, because with load balancing, you can have multiple identical servers, and we're essentially just splitting the traffic across those different servers. They don't need a shared information like a shared database or a shared virtual hard disk file. Anytime you need that singleton, that one source of centralized information, that's when you use failover clustering. So you have a physical server, a second physical server, and they're both attached to some type of shared storage. You put the application's data on that shared storage, such as the virtual machine's virtual hard disk, or your SQL database's database. This way, no matter which of those different hosts is running the VM, it can still access that single consistent view of the data, in this case, the virtual hard disk. Now, with failover clustering in the 2012 R2 release, we do support the largest clusters in the industry, 64 nodes, 8,000 virtual machines. We have a distributed access file system known as cluster shared volumes, which allows us to simultaneously access a single LAN, yet prevent things like corruption and writing over different components. Fully integrated in the Windows networking stack, supporting IPv4, IPv6, 4-to-6 tunneling technologies. And you can even run your applications with static IP addresses or DHCP. So essentially, you want to think of failover clustering as a key requirement to building this platform. Now, when we think about high availability, we've basically talked about high availability on that physical layer, connecting those servers. But there's actually two other places where we even want to go and inject a cluster to provide even more availability. Now, we can do clustering at what we call the guest level as well, which is where we have a collection of virtual machines that run Windows Server, and those VMs are actually connected inside the virtual layer. Now, if you're using Hyper-V running over an SMB file share, you're also going to want to put a scale-out file server cluster in your deployment as well. Now, take it a step back. One of the new features of Hyper-V in Windows Server 2012 R2, is to be able to run it over a remote file share. Now, we talked in the past that Hyper-V or clustering has a requirement for shared storage. In the past, that meant a SAN. That meant fiber channel, iSCSI, serial attached SCSI, fiber channel over Ethernet, one of those kind of traditional shared storage protocols. But we wanted to make things even cheaper and remove that dependency of the SAN. When you kind of think about what is a file share, it's essentially a namespace, WACWAC, MyVMs, or SMB share, that multiple servers can access. So think about if I have a virtual machine running on one server, it's accessing its virtual hard disk through a file share. If I need to move that VM to a different server, that other host can still access that same virtual hard disk on a file share. So that's essentially what Hyper-V over SMB does. It allows us to put the virtual hard disk on a remote file share. Now, this is okay. This is a great solution. It's going to reduce your cost. But anytime we have a file share, we got to remember that it is supported behind it by a file server. And so we want to provide high availability for the file server so that that share stays online so that our virtual machine can always access its virtual hard disk. So if you just have a file server that's a standalone host, the WACWAC share on top of it, and then your VM using that, if you lose that host, you're going to lose the share and your virtual machine is going to stop running. That's a single point of failure. So what we need to do is provide a cluster behind the scenes, and we're actually going to go and configure, in this case, a scale-out file server. What this will do is it will allow us to deploy several nodes, several hosts, and we're actually going to put WACWAC MyShare running on each of those different hosts. So we have four active entry points to our virtual hard disk. If my VM's running on the first host, that host crashes. Instead of stopping the VM, we'll simply fail over the access point, so it will continue to run by passing the data through host 2, host 3, or host 4. So one of the key requirements here is if you're doing Hyper-V over SMB, you want to make sure that you have the scale-out file server in part of your infrastructure so that we can be resilient and always keep that client access point online. So that's my quick introduction to the scale-out file server, but I think we now want to move on and talk about a different concept of elasticity.
Yeah, elasticity is something that gets talked about a lot on the fabric side, so we've just been talking a lot about it. So on our physical infrastructure, we want to have elasticity. We want to be able to grow it and stretch it out. But kind of what's not included in that when we think about it on the fabric side is the fact that when I let it go, it snaps back in, right? So elasticity is actually a back and forth movement. So there's an elasticity that lives on the tenant side above the line that I talked about earlier, and then there's an elasticity on the fabric side. And the elasticity that's enabled in the form of the VM roles in particular, and just in baseline in the ability for tenants to consume resources as they want, you have this potential for them to explode past what they're able to manage, what you're able to, and what you're able to handle. So you have to start thinking about the tools that are going to be able to help you manage the impact of a tenant scaling up and stay at scale as well as scaling down, and doing that whenever they want to, as long as they're operating within some certain boundaries, right? So below the line, there are going to be these are the fabric-oriented tools that you can use to help protect yourself.
That's right. So dynamic optimization, MPRO, which stands for performance and resource optimization, this essentially monitors your fabric, and based on certain metrics, like one of my hosts is using too much memory, we could go trigger a live migration, distribute it so that the load stays balanced and you're not overwhelming a host. Quality of service, or QoS, can be used for both storage and network connections. Essentially, with QoS, you can assign an absolute maximum amount of bandwidth a resource can use, and you can assign a guaranteed minimum amount of bandwidth. This way, if you have lots of virtual machines on a single host, you can ensure that they have sufficient access to their network and their storage, and at the same time, make sure that they don't take up too much of that. You have several capacity planning tools, and in fact, one of our new System Center technologies that's not in the suite is System Center Advisor. Now, if you haven't heard of System Center Advisor, check out www.systemcenteradvisor.com now, and it's a free cloud service that does some best practice analysis actually in your own data center. But one of the new enhancements that's currently available is capacity planning. It's going to read data, it's going to look at trending, and it's going to give you guidance about when you need to go purchase that hardware. So as you're thinking about that elasticity, it can help you figure out when's the right time for me. We also want to think about monitoring the infrastructure. You want to make sure that you don't run out of that capacity so that you can continue to burst. So one good example of monitoring is ensuring that your virtual hard disks or even your physical storage doesn't run out of capacity. So you want to constantly monitor that environment. And we can tie all of these pieces together and make dynamic changes once we introduce automation. So when a problem happens, we can do our best to try to fix it as soon as possible. But what do we have above the line?
Yeah, so above the line, a lot of it is about giving people what they pay for and protecting them from themselves, right? So we're going to use clouds in VMM to serve as our base units of measurement, as high up in and as abstracted as we can in our fabric. Then we're going to take that and we're going to abstract it even farther on the WAP side. And that's going to happen through the form of plans and the capacity associated with them. So what you do is you take the clouds provided by that you create that describe the performance characteristics of your bottom below the line fabric, and then they get associated with plans. So you have multiple plans associated with a cloud, and you know theoretically or just conceptually, the sum total of all the plans could be the sum total of all of the resources in a particular cloud. Then again, you're going to want to start thinking about the monitoring above the line, right? So going back to that core model where there's my minimum viable service, it's perfectly reasonable that someone can go into can use your infrastructure, your fabric, to create their own infrastructure and then monitor it themselves. That's totally possible. As a service provider or as Azure, this is something that happens all the time. In an enterprise, this may be something that you want to implement your own monitoring into, or again, as a service provider, maybe you want to offer that as something additional. Taking it even a step farther, maybe this is somewhere where somebody wants to bring in a cloud service to do the monitoring on top of just what's running inside of the guest OS, right? And then again, on that layer, there's the automation that you can use to sort of protect people from themselves through the form of letting them choose to be protected. So, for example, if you're going to create a plan that's focused on doing doing test, it might be really good to offer it with a 10-day expiration date. So after 10 days, the automation that you have is going to go in, audit the VMs that are running. Anything longer than 10 days, it's going to kill. At the fifth day, it sent an email, but at the end, they're protected from themselves and they're not consuming resources that they don't want to.
Now, another best practice is actually partitioning these resources. Could you kind of give us the overview of that?
Yeah, so I sort of started talking about the clouds in the last slide in VMM and the way that we're going to use them to describe things. And I think the fundamental principle of partitioning shared and pooled resources is that you want to make sure that you do your partitioning as high up as is possible, as close as you can to the most abstract layer, because partitions on the physical layer are expensive, and they that's where you're going to incur the most cost and then lose the benefits of the pooled fabric. So the being able to create multiple classes of services that are defined against the performance requirements of your customers and mapped to the back end characteristics that you've created in your fabric is how you're going to be going ahead and doing that. And you can do that at that abstract layer and still do a little bit of partition down in your physical layer as you move to a more consolidated and homogeneous hardware model. So then it's going to impact itself on that server hardware acquisition layer. And then it's going to also be something that you're going to partition and work with in the form of the VM templates and OS images and all of those things that are presented up to the tenants for them to provision themselves. So those are the kind of bits and pieces that you're going to use for your strategy of how you're going to do all this.
All right, so I think we're going to switch over to our first demo now, but I wanted to ask everybody to vote for our next poll question. So if you're in full screen mode, if you could hit exit to minimize. And our next question is, what in your environment do you have virtualized? Is it just your servers and storage, your servers and networking, or are you now virtualizing all of the above, your storage, your servers, and networking? So please vote in that poll. Back to you, Andy.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and switch over to my demo environment here. And what I've got open here is, let me drag that out of the way. This is VMM for those of you who haven't used it before. And here inside of Virtual Machine Manager, I have a section called Clouds, which is in my VMs and Services tab, my workspace. And each of these clouds are the ability for you to start associating and bundling the physical resources with the asset resources in the library so that you can present those out to Windows Azure Pack. So if you're in Windows Azure Pack and you're looking at your VM service, those are the three things that you're going to be able to see inside of it. So when I look at the properties of one of these clouds, I start looking in and I see, okay, let's look at what this is for. So this is clearly a tenant set of hosts, and these hosts are my logical division of a set of compute capacity, right, that I want to dedicate to tenants. I have the ability to associate multiple networks, logical networks, with this particular cloud. So I have the ability to isolate all of the networks that are on this cloud to just this WAP tenant. Then, if I take a look at storage, this is a bad demo environment, so because I don't have a glorious, robust setup of all the various storage classifications, but if I'm going through and using VMM correctly, every time I add a storage provider, I'm going to want to tag it with a indicator that's sort of human consumable, so you know, the gold, silver, bronze sort of strategy, so that the storage profile for performance or availability or whatever the sets of terms of service that you're defining and working with, those would all be represented here. Then here on the capacity tab, I can start throttling the amount of capacity against the total that I'm allowing people to use. So in this particular example, I have the 256 gig of memory total, and I've assigned to this particular cloud 100. So the 101st, it's just not going to happen, right? And so I've created that cap there so that plans can be provisioned against this, each with their own cap, because I could have a plan that offers a total capacity of 10 gig of RAM, right? And so then I start thinking about my service strategy and my predictability to my customers and what they're going to start seeing, so that if I see that they're reaching their plan cap, this is when I'm going to reach out to them and say, hey, do you want to extend and maybe purchase more capacity? Or just if you're in an enterprise and you know that this is a high privilege line of business, maybe just automatically extend it for them, knowing that you can work with them later in case something bad was going to happen. And then the last thing that I'm showing here is the library tab. And this is where I can start associating the artifacts that I store inside my virtual machine manager library with a cloud as well. So this set of things, which is physical resources, assets, and capacity profiles, all get sort of munched together and then associated with specific service level properties. So I'm going to go ahead and...
All right. Well, while you switch back here, I'm going to answer one of the questions that's now come up a few times. And that is, can scale-out file server actually replace a SAN? So let me kind of clarify that point with using the scale-out file server. That's not going to be your all-purpose SAN. Scale-out file server is specifically designed to support Hyper-V virtual hard disks as that back-end file system. So you can, in fact, use the scale-out file server for all of your virtual machines, allowing them to connect to their virtual hard disk, but you're not going to use that scale-out file server for your things like your SQL database, if it's running on bare metal, for other types of applications. Again, it's specifically designed for your virtual machines to store their virtual hard disks. All right, back to you, Andy. Let's cover our artifacts and publishing.
Yeah. So I was sort of wrapping up there on the clouds by talking about the library. And so this is where we want to start thinking about the things that we're going to start putting in and letting customers consume against. And so one thing that comes up a lot and I hear a lot is, well, what's the difference between a standalone VM and a VM role? And this is one of those places where, it's important to get your head around what your end users and your customers are expecting, because they're able to get it somewhere else, maybe, and they're looking to that feature set and they would like you to have it. So it's again why we are integrating System Center and server with the Azure Pack, is so that you can actually deliver those things. And one of those core things is this VM role and the ability to scale out and scale in a self-service way, pre-configured and easy to consume operating systems plus payloads that live on the operating systems. So that the integration of the payload and the ability to scale in and out is that end user access to the elasticity that they're going to be expecting from your cloud. So I'm going to switch over and take a look at my VM roles. So let me get this up and running real quick.
All right, so while you do that, I had another question that's come in as well, and that is asking us about high availability. Can I actually deploy to a cluster? So the way you want to think about this is, the answer is yes, you can. The way you want to think about it is you're using VMM as that kind of centralized interface. If you have clusters that are managed by Virtual Machine Manager, absolutely, you can certainly use them as a deployment option. So again, kind of depends on your scenario, your infrastructure, but fully supported deploying these virtual machines and making them highly available as you do it.
All right, so what I've got here on the screen is this is my my Azure Pack tenant portal, not the administrator portal. And what we're looking at here is my virtual machines service that I've got as a tenant administrator, which I'm sort of representing there. So here I've got a set of VM roles and standalone VMs. And so you can see that inside of my web tier, I have the ability to have multiple instances of the same machine. And as an end user, I can just scale that out. So you also have the ability, since you own the fabric, you have the ability to customize out what virtual machine roles you make available to your customers through their plans. So I don't want to dwell on that here. I think John's going to talk about that in a bit, but what I do want to do is look at what's happening here. So I can look at this virtual machine role configuration wizard, and we have the ability as fabric administrators and service administrators to author and contribute to these. So let's put in a name there and move on to the more interesting pages. So here's where you're able to go through and choose your amount of resources as an end user, and then pick an operating system disk. In this particular example, I'm only letting you do one as a service administrator. That's probably the best one and is what's suited here. So it's the mixture of choice and not choice that makes for good service providing, because you want to allow end users to customize what's safe and preserve the standardization on what might not be. So in this particular case, I have this local administrator credential, but it's hard-coded and it can't be changed, whereas I can change the password. So Whoops. All right, so hopefully those match.
Looks like they do, yep.
And then one thing that you can also do when you're customizing these VM role templates is you can establish requirements. And so this computer name pattern, it has to be there, so I'll just put in something so I can move on. And then I have the ability as an end user to choose what virtual network that I created, and in this case, Contoso, and then I can move forward to the next page of the wizard, where this is where the payload configurations and a lot of the extra modifications to incorporate a full deployment of something or configurations of something like IIS could live inside of the template. So here we have the ability to modify the domain and all of these kinds of things. And then there are the SQL Server specific items that have been authored in the VM role in the back end. So you can see here that it's got a default of 300, but I can change it to 400 and it's okay with that. So those are the VM roles. And with that, I kind of want to switch back to...
Okay, so I'm going to answer kind of a follow-up question that we had about deploying deploying to a highly available host. The second question is, can I go and deploy a guest cluster? And again, this is where our actual virtual machines are already gone and connected there. So Andy, do you want to take that one?
I'm sorry.
Okay, I'll take
my next slide. Sorry, man.
So our next question is, can you actually go deploy a guest cluster through WAP?
It can be done, I believe. I've seen
not out of the box,
it's
right?
Not, it's yeah, this is something that you're going to want to be able to do. And I don't know. I haven't seen it done personally in deployment. I've seen some blog posts and some write-ups.
Yeah.
People are starting to do that as people start to get more and more creative with what's there.
So not out of the box, but it certainly can be done with some work. Because when you think about deploying a guest cluster, you got to set up VM1, set up VM2, and then actually create a virtual network between them so that they can communicate with each other. So that might be done through multiple steps, or if you've gone and add some special custom code on it, or maybe some automation through SMA, which we'll get to in module 5, it would be possible. All right, let's go back through our the high-level workflow I think we're on.
Yeah,
right?
So I showed you what that end-user experience is of the VM role, and now I want to kind of walk through the life cycle of how these VM roles come into being. And so at a high level, you're going to grab the package, customize it or modify it however you want as a fabric or service administrator, and then you're going to go ahead and you're going to get a couple of different sets of files, and you're going to need to put them in the right places. So there are certain files that need to live in VMM, and then certain files that need to be registered into WAP. And then once that's all done and everything's lined up, then the service administrator is able to take the gallery items and add them to plans so that they show up. So that Contoso administrator I had the premium plan, so every possible thing was there. If you wanted to, there could only be one of those roles there. It all depends on how you want to do and operate your service. So then the tenant is going to go ahead and consume those through the wizard, and then those become the instantiated VMs. So the way that you obtain the gallery, the VM role gallery items is through the web platform installer. So the web platform installer has got a collection of baseline units for you to work with and modify and to get up and running and to help get you started down this path. And there's a link here at the bottom that isn't showing up exactly, but you can go ahead and take a look at that blog post that explains how to use it. But I'm going to go ahead and switch over as quick as I can back to my demo environment and take a look at this. So what I've got here is I've got my web platform installer up and running, and I've got the ability to go in and configure the options of it. And what you do is you end up putting in a custom feed that's described in the blog post, and you add that feed to the web platform installer, and what you're gonna see is a new tab shows up here called service models at the top. And so in the using the web platform installer and the service models feed, you can see here that I've got these two options. And so I've got the set of things that apply as virtual machine manager service templates, and then there are gallery resources. And so service templates are something that you can create with VMM, but actually aren't used by WAP. So what WAP is going to do is it's going to use these gallery resources. And so what I've got here is a big long list of things that have been pre-created. And for an example, I'm going to grab this same SQL one. I'm going to install it, and that's just going to go ahead and download it and drop it into a folder so that I can start working on it. And so when I actually open it up, what do I end up seeing? I see these two files. I see a resdef package, and I see the resx package. And I also get a readme doc. And inside the readme doc, with pretty much every one of these that I've ever opened up, there's a detailed set of instructions for how you're going to go ahead and use it. And it walks you through pretty much end-to-end the explanation for how all of those custom elements have been designed and are in there. So when I switch over, I'm going to go over to my folder here. And what I've done is I've sort of pre-created the ability to jump inside of those and take a look. So if I open up this resdef package, you can see this is where I've got all the various properties and settings, but I've also got these associated logo files that I can use to customize out my gallery items. So what I've done is I've grabbed a tool that's available to download. It's the VMroll authoring tool. It's something that the CAT team put together inside of Microsoft and have made publicly available. And what you do with the VMroll authoring tool is you add in the resdef package and the resx package, and you can modify them from here. And I'm mostly using this now, not to modify, but honestly, it's a good way to get your head around all of the various components of the VMroll files. So when I take a look at what's in here, I can start seeing that I have the ability to name things, publish things, set all sorts of references and parameters. I can set out the scale out nature of my VMroll and modify it. I can configure where it's going to pull the VM size and the storage associated with it. So there's the OS disk and a data disk, which is where you're going to usually put, like for in a SQL example, you would have a sysprepped install of SQL sitting, and then you'd be able to deploy it. And then if I go down into the resource extension, this is where I start seeing that payload that I have associated. In this case, it's SQL. It could be Exchange. It could be anything really, right? Or it could be something custom that you have. And so what I've got here is I've got the ability to look at the various resource requirements. So in this particular one, this is one of the most important things right here. And this is something that you may find yourself using the VMroll authoring tool to look up if you're working with one, is what are the OS virtual hard disk tags? So these tags are something that you're going to have to apply to the base VHDs so that the VMroll is able to identify the correct operating system based on the requirements of what's installed inside of it so that it can go ahead and deploy. So again, you can associate lots and lots of scripts and the deployment order for all the things that live inside. And then the last thing I kind of want to show you is this view definition. So this is another thing that's contained inside of it. And this view definition is where you actually set up the pages of that of the wizard as you walk through. So, you know, I think I showed was the database size. So in this particular example, here's where that 300 value is set, and I can modify it here and republish. And then I can also toggle at this layer to say, this is a required field, and I don't want you to be able to progress past without filling this out. So I think that was a pretty speedy view through all of the various files associated in the VMroll. So I'm going to go ahead and switch back. And again, here, I'm not going to talk through all of this, but I just wanted to get this here so it's on everybody's radar. These are all of the various elements that are associated with the different components. And then at the bottom, I've got a link there for you all to get to that VMroll authoring tool. So I'm going to move on. And so here's sort of that high-level relationship. So the resdef package contains and is associated with the application package in the form of the resx. And then the viewdef, think of it a lot like the answer file that you're going to use it to collect the answers for an answer file that you're going to use to deploy. And then at deploy time, when the tenant initiates that activity, it's going to parse out all that information and instantiate the virtual machine role according to the parameters that you've defined. So one thing I emphasized in that last section was I made the point about those OS tagging. One of the things that goes on is that the OS images should be parameterized so that they can be used according to as many different roles as possible. So that's why you saw things like this was, you know, Windows Server 2012. It had, you know, .NET 3.5. It could have an R2 tag. All those little tags let you have a minimal set of very identifiable OS images that you manage and then associate multiple payloads with. So there's a script for tagging VHDs that I've got up and posted for you that you can use. It's sort of a little tagging tool to get you started with how to do it. This was something that actually was really hard for me when I first started working with the gallery items. I had to ask lots and lots of questions and get help until I got this script made. So I'm going to go ahead and show you guys how to do that as I think the last demo that I've got. So I'm going to switch over to my demo environment.
Now, while you do that, I'll just share the results from the last poll we have. We asked, what is everyone's level of virtualization adoption? And about 5% of you actually aren't virtualized at all. So definitely something that hopefully you'll see the benefits from after attending this training. We see about 40% of you are just doing server virtualization. About 30% are doing all three, storage, network, and server. About 20% are doing server and storage, 10% server and network. So we kind of got a pretty big range here, but it looks like about 94% of you are virtualizing something, which is great. All right, back to the demo.
Okay, so what I've got here, I've got PowerShell open on my VMM box. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to run this PowerShell command. It's the get virtual hard disk. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to emphasize that I'm going to get the tag property. So I'm going to kick this off and run it. Ooh, that was really fast. That was awesome. And what I'm going to look for is I'm going to try to find one where it's there. So here's a blank disk that I've got, and it has no tag. And then what I've got here on this one is I've got a Windows Server 2012 OS disk, and I've tagged it as R1 to specify that anything that's in a VM role should be associated with that. And then it's also got .NET 3.5. So one of the things that I've done is I've gone ahead and created some just sort of jumpstart. Let me try to find one for it. It's sort of hard to see here. There we go. So I've got this jumpstart1.bhd, and it's got the .NET 3.5 and the jumpstart tag. And so if I switch over to my little tagging tool, I'm going to say, okay, I want to apply a tag to jumpstart1.bhd, and then I'm going to check to see if it does not have a tag, and I'm going to just go ahead and modify this a little bit for the sake of the demo. I'm going to add that there, and say that if it doesn't have that tag, to go ahead and add the tag, right? It's pretty much that simple using this little widget. So I'm going to run this script, and then let's see how long that takes. Did that work? It did. So right here, I just added that tag. And so go ahead and grab that script to get started on tagging. It'll save you guys a bunch of time in terms of trying to figure out how to get that done. And then those OS images are what you're going to store in your VHD folder inside of your VMM library.
Great. Well, as we switch back, I think we also want to mention one of the tools which is available, right? Can you talk a little bit about this import tool, the gallery resource import tool?
One second, let me get this back to the deck.
All right.
Yep. So another thing, so that VM role authoring tool is something that was created and is free to download so that to help you get you started. And this is another tool that you can use to help get you started, because when you go ahead and you download those different packages, you have to import via PowerShell the files into VMM and then import a different set of files to WAP. And that is all documented for exactly what you need to do inside each one of those README files, as well as do the OS tagging and a couple of other things that you can do through the VMM UI that I skipped because it's pretty straightforward. So this tool has been made so that you can walk through and it will go ahead and tag the OS the VHDs for you, as well as import those objects into the various places that you need to. So I showed you how to do it manually in case you wanted to know what's happening. And so once you know what's going on, it's a lot easier to start implementing a tool to go ahead and automate that process.
Great. Well, I think we're just about done with this session, right?
Yeah, so...
You want to quickly summarize
this?
Yeah,
let's go ahead. So, I mean, I think fundamentally what we really wanted you to take away is that we're not managing servers in this model.
That's right.
Delivering things as services. We need to focus on delivering services. And servers, we all know them, we all love them, but in this scale-up, scale-down model, you can't get married to a server because it could disappear at any time and it was out of your control by design. So the way that you approach the things that you've taken for granted for a long time has to change a little bit. And the way to think about that is to get focused on delivering services. And then you're going to want to remember to purpose build your cloud fabric to tailored to those services. and then follow the best practices. And then, like I said here, I've got my tool set listed out for you for things to get you started on working on the customization element of the VM roles in the Windows Azure Pack.
Great. Well, with that, we're going to wrap up our first section. I just want to remind you again of our resources, such as the Microsoft Virtual Academy. So if you want to really get that deep dive on Virtual Machine Manager itself, go back to the Microsoft Virtual Academy and take one of our courses there. Well, Andy, I want to thank you for joining me. Also, I want to thank Andy, as he was one of our behind-the-scenes guys that helped set up, organize this entire program for you, as Windows Azure Pack is his baby now, right?
It sure is.
What, one of a couple.
It's a big baby.
Well, we'll be back in about 10 minutes, and then we're going to start to look at some of our different service delivery models. Thanks again, Andy. We'll see you soon.